Dr. Patel, it's great to have you with us today. We're talking obviously about health equity. So at AmeriCares, we believe that health equity is achieved when every person has a fair and just opportunity to live their healthiest life. I think oftentimes we hear health equity and we think about our physical health, sort of our traditional medical health. But I'm curious, what's your definition of mental health equity?
Well, thanks, Erica. So for me, quite simply, it's the same principle as health equity applied for physical health, but in this instance, applied to the specific domain of mental health, which translates into the realization or the attainment of a similar high quality of mental health, regardless of one's station in life or one's social demographic characteristics. In reality, Erica, poor mental health is disproportionately experienced by low-income communities, historically disadvantaged and marginalized communities. And this is the inequity that we need to address while we simultaneously try to improve the mental health of the entire population.
Where do you think that inequity comes from? Is it solely an issue of economics, or is there more to it?
Well, I mean, definitely economics plays a very big role, but there is more to it. I think if you consider the risk factors for poor mental health as one example, such as adversities in one's early life experiences, people who live in low-income communities and other marginalized groups are likely to experience a much greater load of these adverse life experiences in childhood, which in turn, of course, increases the risk to develop mental health problems. Let's give another example, which is that access to good quality education is known to be one of the most protective factors for mental health. And again, it goes without saying that vulnerable disadvantaged groups in the population have poorer access to quality education. And a third and final example is access to good quality care is so important to enable one to recover when one has a mental health problem. And again, these are the same groups that will have inequitable access to the kind of quality care that we know works.
So to that end, you have a real focus on what you refer to as a rights-based approach to care, which certainly comes into play when we're talking about mental health equity. Can you just, share with our audience what you mean by that rights-based approach?
Well, I think that I think of rights, I mean, the word rights, I think is self-explanatory. It's an entitlement that every citizen must have towards whatever public good we are talking about. In this case, that public good is mental health, and I want to frame it as a public good. So there are many different kinds of rights. The first is a right to be protected from known harms to our mental health, such as adversities in our childhood or exposure to violence. The second is the right to care of one's choice. And I want to emphasize one's choice because the low-income communities or minority groups are often denied the choice when there is such a choice for care, for example, between medication and psychotherapy. Mm-hmm. The third is a right to freedom. And that might sound a bit odd, but honestly, the numbers of individuals with mental illness who are incarcerated, I think, is a national crisis. But again, this right is enjoyed disproportionately in the population. An overwhelming number of people with mental illness who are incarcerated are people of color, for example, or come from low-income backgrounds. And finally, the right not to be discriminated against, for example, in school or in the workplace. I think these are just a set of fundamental rights which I think everyone with mental health problems is entitled to, but that these rights are inequitably experienced by the very groups I mentioned earlier.
I do want to just pick up, you mentioned COVID and how COVID has exacerbated some issues. Can you just drill down on that a little bit? What do you see in terms of gaps and barriers to achieving mental health equity and even to chipping away at that stigma and even the stereotypes that are out there? How has COVID made that either better or worse in your view?
So the pandemic, Erica, represents in my mind the world's first truly global humanitarian crisis. I can't think of any, at least in my lifetime, any crisis that has affected the entire global population at roughly the same time. Uncertainties and losses are major factors contributing to poor mental health. And if one considers the sheer breadth of uncertainties and losses, and how long and enduring these have lasted, it's nearly been 2 years now. It is not at all surprising that experiences of poor mental health have become widespread. In my reading, these are mostly rational responses of our minds to the extraordinary circumstances that we're facing. That said, when you increase the population prevalence of distress, inevitably this will fuel an increase in the numbers of people who have clinically significant mental disorders. And what really worries me even more is that this increase will be amplified by the impact of the economic recession, which, as you know, affects different groups very disproportionately. A few of us have become fabulously wealthy, whereas a large numbers of people have even lost their jobs. The widening of inequalities, the polarization that we see around issues like vaccination, and the continuing uncertainties about the future waves of the epidemic. I think all of these combined continue to bite into our mental health. The pandemic has also, I think, brought into sharp relief the structural inequalities that existed before the pandemic. And people who are already disadvantaged or vulnerable for one reason or the other, for example, young people, low-income groups, and people who had an existing mental disorders have been especially badly hit. How many people really know that comorbidity with mental illness, just like comorbidity with diabetes, greatly increases your risk of severe COVID or dying? I think this is an example of an established inequity that was there before the pandemic, which has been amplified by the pandemic.
So part of what you're doing, right, part of your work is to look at solutions and to look at, in your current research, as you're prioritizing things, solutions that are out there that can work to help those dealing with mental health issues, to destigmatize and to really bring this to the forefront. So I'm wondering if you could walk through, you know, part of what you talked about, that one of the things that really stood out to me is developing and evaluating non-specialist provider delivered interventions. So we're not just talking about, in my understanding, psychiatrists, psychologists, for example, but expanding the group of those who could offer care when it comes to mental health. What does that look like?
So Erica, thanks for that question. You know, this is, of course, goes to the heart of my own work. Let me start by saying that the most innovative healthcare delivery solution, which has emerged from global health, which is a euphemism for low resource parts of the world, is that of the task sharing of healthcare interventions with non-physician frontline providers. This has a long history, and it was initially championed for maternal and child health and then subsequently for infectious diseases. But over the past decade, task sharing has been adapted for the delivery of mental health interventions. Just a couple of weeks ago, a large body of evidence, now nearly 100 randomized controlled trials from over 40 countries, was put together in a systematic review, which demonstrated the effectiveness of frontline worker delivered psychosocial interventions for the prevention and care of a range of mental health problems. This is probably the largest body of delivery science in my mind for the field of mental health, and I believe the most transformative of all. People often ask me, what's typical about these interventions? So these interventions are typically built around the building of specific psychological skills in the individual. They often address not just the psychological symptoms, but also the social determinants that we know often accompany mental health problems. They tend to be quite brief, and they're typically delivered in community settings or, of course, during the COVID era through telemedicine. Now, the global impact of this work has been enormous, Erica. This is now a kind of an innovation that is no longer, there's no equipoise, there's no question, does it work? It's now been embraced by all the major global policy institutions like the World Health Organization and many national policy instruments, such as, for example, here in the US. And to give you an example of how these innovations are coming to the US, a brief treatment for depression involving six sessions based on the principle of behavioral activation. It's one of the cognitive behavioral principles that was developed in India, has now been adapted for delivery to moms in Canada and the US, making this perhaps the first ever example of a mental health intervention developed in a low resource country being used here in the US. So to me, this is the most exciting thing. And I want to just end by saying something it keeps me awake day and night with excitement. And that is our attempts to scale up these innovations by building the workforce capacity of frontline workers, such as community health workers, nurses, social workers, and so on, to learn, master, and deliver psychological treatments through the initiative called Empower, which is launched at Harvard Medical School, which comprises a suite of digital tools to actually build the workforce. And just in June this year, thanks to the Lone Star Prize, we will be rolling out community health worker depression care in underserved communities of Texas over the next 4 years in partnership with the Meadows Mental Health Policy Institute and the University of Texas. And I'm hoping that the platform over the next few years will expand its suite of content to include anxiety problems, trauma, youth mental health problems, and harmful drinking.
So really quickly, because I know we're tight on time, this all sounds so exciting and so wonderful because we're expanding, right, the opportunities to provide more equitable care when it comes to mental health. We know how overwhelmed so many frontline workers are, healthcare workers in general, especially because of the pandemic. How does that training work? How much more is it adding to what they're already doing? And how receptive have they been?
Well, so far we found that people are so enthusiastic because these are providers who already engage with people around life problems, social determinants, and they often struggle then with the psychological symptoms that the people that they're supporting are experiencing. This empowers them literally to actually provide person-centered holistic care. Luckily, the people we're working with in Texas already have financing systems in place, but that is a very important issue. How do you scale up isn't just about training and supervising and supporting people, but also ensuring that they're adequately compensated. And I believe that the policy imperative is that the new funds that are being allocated to build back better our mental health care systems must include a significant allocation for actually compensating frontline workers for being the frontline, you know, the frontline army for mental health care. And importantly, Erica, it's important to know we're talking about an extension of the existing mental health care system to expand its footprint into the community to reach those who historically have rarely accessed mental health care, while at the same time making sure that those who do need more specialized care can very quickly access it through referral by the frontline workers. So I want to be clear, we're not talking about a replacement of the mental health care system or a silo separate from the mental health care system, but actually an expansion of the mental health care system.
An expansion working in concert. It's so important. We could continue talking about this all afternoon. Unfortunately, I know we have to leave it there, but Dr. Vikram Patel, really appreciate your time and thank you for sharing some of your passion and your work with us today. And we look forward to continuing the conversation here.
Thank you, Erica.